So you've deployed your landing zone in the cloud and you think you're ready to start your migration, but not so fast. There are 7 things that you need to do or migrating into your new dream home in the cloud is gonna turn into a nightmare. Now, part of your landing zone deployment was to set up your express route or site-to-site VPN or VWAN. But that's just the Azure side of the equation. You still need to set up your on-prem side for these connections, or things will be over before they even start. If you chose an express route, you'll need to work with your provider to set up your express route circuit and then connect that circuit to Azure and back to on-prem with your gateway. If you've gone down the VPN path, you'll need to set up the gateway connection and the local network in order for those things to communicate. And VWAN has its own gateway connections that you need to do as well. Once you finally get everything connected with on-prem and the cloud, there's 6 more things to think about. And I've even brought some other experts in to help you out. And it's all covered here in this new doc, which I'll have linked in the video description below.
You don't want to migrate your workloads to the cloud without thinking about your domain controllers first. Unless you are transitioning to a cloud-only environment, you are going to need to extend your DCs to Azure because you don't want to have to authenticate all the way back to on-premises, since it would increase your latency and logon times, and of course, decrease reliability. There is no secret sauce to make a domain controller in the cloud. You just need to build a VM and promote it to be a domain controller. Don't forget, you will need to have a VPN or express route to connect on-premises to the cloud, so DCs can talk to each other. And then we need one more thing. Create a new site in AD Sites and Services and add your Azure subnets to it, which will tell the other VMs in Azure that the new DC is the closest one to make authentication as fast as possible.
Unless you just deployed a cloud-only landing zone, you're going to need to get your existing users into the cloud. And we do that with the new Cloud Sync tool or Azure AD Connect. You install these tools on a server on-prem, and it syncs your users to the cloud along with all their AD properties and metadata. But what about your passwords? We protect them with a feature called Password Hash Sync. It generates a hash of the password and only syncs the hash, not the password. This keeps everything secure, and your users use the same password on-prem and in the cloud. When the user signs in, a reverse of the hash is done, and if everything matches up, you get signed in.
Active Directory domains needs DNS to work, and we have 2 parts to this puzzle. We have the cloud side and the on-prem side. We already talked about setting up your virtual network so all your VMs in the cloud can find your DCs. But if you're on-prem and you want to get to Azure PaaS services like Azure Files or a private endpoint, you need something called a conditional forwarder. Here in your DNS server at the bottom, you have a conditional forwarders. Adding a new one needs a fully qualified domain name and the IP address that it resolves to, which is always 168.63.129.16. Now, what about resolving from the cloud back to on-prem? To make that happen, we need the Azure DNS Private Resolver. You just set up an outbound endpoint with the targets on-prem and you're good to go.
As part of deploying your landing zone, it is important for you to monitor your new cloud resources as well as Azure service health, so you know everything is running in the cloud as it should be. The easiest way to do this is deploying the Azure Monitor Baseline for landing zone. This will use Azure policy to set up the monitoring alerts we all need for landing zone management, like your VM and cloud services health. That way you can get notified on anything that goes wrong so you can deal with it fast.
Just having your Azure firewall deployed, it doesn't actually do anything. In order for it to be effective, you need to route traffic to it and set up the rules for the traffic that you want to control. If any traffic needs to leave your spoke network, then it should be sent to the firewall for inspection. To do this, every subnet in your spoke networks needs to have a route table, and there should be a route for 0.0.0.0/0, which will send all your outgoing traffic to your firewall. Now, you can have additional routes that are more specific as needed. For example, if you want traffic that is going to on-prem to be inspected by the firewall, you'll also need to plan for its routing. And you do this in 2 parts. First, the spoke route tables need BGP propagation disabled. Otherwise, it'll try to go to the gateway directly. Second, the gateway subnet needs a route table. You'll need to add every CIDR block used by your spoke networks. And before you ask, no, you can't supernet them because it will use the most specific route. Now that all of your traffic is headed to the Azure firewall, it's going to block everything by default. So you need to add your rules to allow the traffic that you want to flow. And those rules can be set up either as a network rule or as an application rule.
Azure can protect your new landing zone with Defender for Cloud. You need to enable it for the different aspects of your subscription, and Defender for Cloud helps you improve your security posture with a security score, which evaluates your cloud resources against Microsoft Security Baseline and suggests improvements. And you should keep checking back for new recommendations as you begin migrating your resources into Azure so everything stays secure.
Thanks for your help, everybody. Now that you have these seven key areas all set up and ready to go, you're ready to start your migration, which itself has five keys that you need to get everything right. And you can learn about that right over here. Happy learning.